Good morning, my dear students. Today we are going to discuss about general anesthetics. General anesthetics are the drugs which can produce reversible loss of all sensations, especially consciousness. Okay, so the what is the definition of anesthesia means? Anesthesia is derived from the Greek word an means without and aesthesis means sensation. So mainly an anesthetologist is you can give the drugs during surgery mainly to maintain anesthesia condition for the surgery procedure to be done by the doctor or physician. Okay, so what are the cardinal features of general anesthetics are especially loss of all sensation, especially pain. Okay, so loss of all sensations means if you are touching the particular surgery part or you are pinching with needles and using incisions like that, at the time pain will be very high. So the person should not feel the pain. That is one first and foremost important thing. And also these drugs will produce sleep. Means not complete deep sleep, it will produce unconsciousness. The person will be in a unconscious state. He is unable to see or remember the things. That means amnesia. Amnesia means loss of memory. Okay, and also abolition of somatic and autonomic reflexes. Abolition of somatic and autonomic reflexes means whenever the impulse transmission is there in the particular regions, then automatically the person will be moving or disturbing the position of the body or part of the body going to be surgery. So this should not occur. And immobility and muscle relaxation, this is also important point for in surgery condition. The person should not move continuously, and also the muscle relaxation should be there. Then only whatever the sutures we are giving and maintaining after surgery is will be very easy. So these are the four points, main cardinal features of general anesthesia. If you see previously, the person will be holding by so many persons, and after that only the person is going to give sutures to a particular part or incisions or any wounds occurred, they will be cleaned and sutures will be given without any anesthesia. So nowadays it is not nowadays because of this general anesthetics it become very easy. Whenever in the 19th centuries, especially in mid 19th century, the general anesthetics like alcohol, opium, cannabis, or even asphyxia were used to abandon surgical pain. That means these are not anesthetics, especially they will relieve pain, opium, and they will be giving hallucination to the person. But this is very they are not in a complete sensation condition. Okay, later on in Horace Wells, a dentist picked up the idea of using nitrous oxide. Nitrous oxide, you know, it is a laughing gas. Mainly it can with a minimal dosage of laughing gas, then they can produce the anesthesia condition. This is one thing. And especially this nitrous oxide is identified by Horace Wells in 1844. And later the dentist medical student he at Boston in the Morton region, he identified experimentally on animals ether as a anesthesia in 1846. Okay, so ether is also one of the main drug which will produce general anesthesia as an inhalational agent. Later on, Simpson in Britain, he identified chloroform in 1847. Okay, and later on cyclopropane, halothane in 1956 and thiopentone in 1935, all these were introduced as anesthetic agents. Okay, so this is a brief history of the general anesthetics. And come, this is the classification. You can go for the classification in tripathi. It will be good. And for inhalational anesthetics, the gaseous will be nitrous oxide, and volatile liquids will be ether, halothane, enfluorine, isoflurane, desflurane, and sevoflurane. And coming to intravenous condition, the inducing agents are thiopentone, methohexitone, sodium propofol, and etomidate. And benzodiazepines will be slower acting, which are diazepam, lorazepam, and midazolam. Dissociative anesthesia is mainly ketamine, and neuroleptic analgesia is fentanyl. Okay, so what is the main mechanism of action of general anesthetics? This coming to the inhalational anesthetics, this mainly depends on the minimum alveolar concentration of the drug. So what is a minimum alveolar concentration? It is denoted by MAC. Mainly it is defined as a minimum alveolar concentration that prevents movement in response to surgical stimulation in 50% of the subjects. Okay, so that means if 50% of the subjects we are testing, they are immobilized, then it will be very easy to identify. Okay, and the minimum concentration at which it is producing therapeutically beneficial for the drugs, beneficial for the anesthesia, is determined as minimum alveolar concentration, which is correlated with oil gas partition coefficient. Why we need to take about oil gas partition coefficient means, you know that our body is made up of lipid bilayer, and most of the tissues and everything is every outer layers consists of this lipid more. And this gaseous substance which is moving transition from what we inhaled from alveoli to the blood and to the tissues, then the diffusion process is more, then the drug will be more effective. Okay, so this is the main point to be noted, that is minimum alveolar concentration and oil gas partition coefficient. These two conditions to be monitored for the drugs to give us inhalational anesthetics. For intravenous agents, we need to check for plasma concentration. The minimum concentration at which the response can be abolished is taken as the main concentration of the drug to be produced. Okay, so the what is the general mechanism of action of these drugs means, so mainly these will act on GABA-A receptor gated chloride channel. You know this, GABA is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. What is GABA? Gamma aminobutyric acid, which is an inhibitory neurotransmitter. This is found throughout the CNS, especially whenever this is acting on the alpha subunit, alpha beta subunit will be activated by barbiturates especially. Okay, so whenever it is activated, mainly the chloride channel will be opened, and this chloride channel opens, what happens? This will cause hyperpolarization. Whenever hyperpolarization is caused, automatically what happens? The tissues will not be able to depolarize immediately. It will take a long time to get again depolarized. Okay, so this hyperpolarization condition is taken as a main criteria. And coming to these drugs will also act on NMDA receptors and glutamate receptors. So what is NMDA? N-methyl D-aspartate type of glutamate receptors. So these are mainly present on NMDA type of receptors, mainly present on nicotinic regions. These are drugs which will act mainly by inhibiting NMDA are nitrous oxide and ketamine. Okay, and glycine. This glycine is also an excitatory neurotransmitter, It activates chloride channel in spinal cord and medulla. The drugs which act by glycine are barbiturates, propofol. Okay, and some other drugs such as ketamine. Sometimes the other drugs will also act on both the ion channels, and some will act on the nicotinic cholinergic receptors. You know, this nicotinic cholinergic receptors are present in ganglia, NN type and NM type in muscles. So these will mainly helpful for production of analgesia and amnesia condition. Analgesia means relieving of pain, and amnesia means loss of memory will be caused by acting on the nicotinic receptors. Especially barbiturates and fluorinated anesthetics will be useful for this. Especially fentanyl also act by this mechanism. One important thing is NMDA type of receptors mainly act on calcium selective cation channels in the neurons, inhibition of which appears to be primary mechanism of anesthetic action of ketamine as well as nitrous oxide. So what does that mean? Mainly by activating on the calcium selective cation channels, whenever this calcium is inhibited, automatically the impulse transmission and reflexes at that particular region will also be inhibited. Okay, so this is the main mechanism. What is the first and foremost mechanism means? By activating on the GABA channel. Okay, so this is a mechanism of action of the, and coming to stages of anesthesia, in overall general anesthesia, this four stages of anesthesia is very, very important, and this is mainly traditional description of signs and stages of anesthesia will be by Godel's sign. Okay, so mainly he referred with ether in 1920. Okay, so and he divided all the different stages and conditions of a particular person after anesthesia into four stages. But nowadays those are not present. I will discuss why those are not present nowadays. And this slow action as lipid soluble, that is ether, and descending depression of CNS, higher to lower areas of brain are involved, and vital centers located in medulla are got paralyzed. Okay, so these conditions will show different stages, what happens during this paralyzed condition. First one is stage of analgesia. This starting from beginning of anesthetic inhalation and lasts up to loss of consciousness. That means the person, he can hear, see and feel, but he is not in a particular, complete consciousness will not be present. Okay, that means he cannot be able to move from the place and he cannot talk like that. Okay, but he can hear and see the conditions. So whenever, immediately after injecting anesthesia, at which time he is losing consciousness, that is stage 1. In this stage, there will be reflexes and respiration remain normal. Okay, but the very short procedure like dental excision, like that we can do. Okay, or small incisions that we can do in this condition, but it is not that much preferable. Okay, so that means minor ops, that means very damage incision occurs there, then we can give stitches, like that. At that condition we can go for stage of analgesia. And second stage is stage of delirium and excitement. Especially we'll call it a stage of delirium. This is from loss of consciousness to beginning of regular respiration. Okay, so this the patient can shout, struggle and hold his breath, muscle tone increases, jaws are tightly closed and breathing is jerky, vomiting condition may occur, and involuntary micturition and defecation. All these conditions will be present in a stage of delirium. Delirium means nothing but it is a dreamlike state, but the patient is highly excited and anxiety condition will be more. Okay, and this condition we cannot perform any kind of surgery at this condition. Okay, so we should not even touch the person with our instruments, everything. Okay, that is the second stage. Okay, and coming to third stage, it is called as a stage of surgical anesthesia. Most of the surgical operations can be performed in this stage of surgical anesthesia. It extends from onset of regular respiration to cessation of spontaneous breathing. Okay, that means so in I will show you diagram. The respiration will be very shallow in the delirium condition, and it will be increasing in the stage 2. Okay, so finally what happens, whenever it is reaching the end of surgical anesthesia, the respiration will be very narrow. Okay, that means cessation means finally it is going to decrease. Okay, and this can be divided into 4 planes. That means plane 1 is roving of eyeballs. This plane ends when eyes become fixed. Roving of eyeballs means if you see a person before going to sleep, the eyes will be moving here and there like that. Okay, that means we cannot open our eyelid, but eye will be moving. Okay, so this condition is mainly seen in this one, and at which the eyes become fixed means the pupil or it won't be moved. That means dilation and relaxation of ciliary muscles, everything will be inhibited. And in plane 2, loss of corneal and laryngeal reflexes will be caused, and that means no salivation, secretions and gland secretions, all will be inhibited. And in plane 3, pupil starts dilating and light reflex is lost. Especially whenever pupil starts dilating, as we discussed in atropine condition, in mydriatic state what happens, the pupil size will be increased, and it whenever it is reaching its maximum size, it will be fixed and light. Whenever we are giving a torch also, the person will not close his eyes. That is, light reflex will be lost in this condition. And in plane 4, intercostal paralysis occurs. That means the respiration will be by intercostal muscles present in the thoracic region. This will be inhibited, and shallow abdominal respiration will be started, where is present. If you see a person who is having breathing problem, he will take with mouth, and sometimes and abdomen will be in a respiratory state. We can see the changes in our abdomen. That is called as a shallow abdominal respiration. And also dilated pupil, we can see complete dilation of the pupil will be present in this condition. Okay, so in this plane 4, we cannot never attempt any surgeries and all. Okay, and also the person should not reach at this condition. Especially we should give to relieve anesthesia condition, we are giving antidotes. Okay, so that will be given in this stage, end of the stage 2, where operation procedure has been completed. Okay, so this is about the stage 3. And coming to stage 4, it is called as medullary or respiratory paralysis. In this condition, if you are not controlling at the plane 3 of the surgical anesthesia, then this will reach to medullary cessation of breathing in medullary paralysis. And this will, if your respiration is not proper, automatically our breathing will be affected, and circulation will be in a great failure. Exchange of gases will be inhibited, and circulation will be in a problem, and the person will lead to death. And pupil is widely dilated, and muscles are totally flabby, pulse is thready or imperceptible, and blood pressure is very low. So these are the main conditions we can see. So whenever many of the above conditions will be relieved by pre anesthetic and post anesthetic drugs. So that means if you go for atropine, it will cause a decrease in pupillary and heart rate will be normal. Okay, and going for morphine, the respiration condition will be controlled, and some muscle relaxants we can go after before surgery. That is muscle relaxants, these will cause such as succinylcholine and those one, and also some opioids. These will cause muscle tone, respiration, eye movements, reflexes. All these will be in a controlled condition. Okay, so that pre-anesthetic and post-anesthetic drugs should be taken care of during anesthesia condition. And also, whenever we a combination of two inhalational anesthetics, that is nitrous oxide and isoflurane is used, their MACs are additive. That means lower concentration of each is required for causing maximum alveolar concentration. Okay, so like this we can have to check for the combination of the drugs while giving by basing on the stages of the particular what response of the person to for the drug. So this is the condition, and these are the different stages of general anesthesia. You can see in this diagram in a triparty book. Okay, and coming to, so I told you that why nowadays these four stages are not present. One thing is first and foremost thing is rapid activity of drugs, you know, dissociative anesthesia and faster acting drugs we are choosing nowadays. Nowadays it is compulsory that everything should be faster. So drugs also became like that, and faster. Previously we need to wait for 1 hour, 2 hour for the surgery after giving anesthesia, but nowadays within 10 minutes the anesthesia is going to be injected, and it is very faster. Okay, and mechanical control of respiration can be by ventilation, by keeping ventilators and monitoring by ECG, everything. There are so many equipment is high quality equipments are arranged in a particular operation theater for monitoring the conditions of body. And pre-operative and post-operative drugs, especially atropine, what we discussed for dilation of pupil, and opioid depressing of respiration and smooth muscle relaxants, all these are given for the as a drugs of before and after surgery. Okay, so that's why this condition is not present in the nowadays. Okay, and coming to pharmacokinetics of the inhalational anesthetics, these anesthetics, inhalational anesthetics, we mainly depend on MAC and partial pressure of gas in the brain. This is important. So whenever the gas is inspired, immediately it will enter into the alveoli. In alveoli there is both arterial vessel and venous blood vessel. So whenever this arterial vessel is the gas is flowing, it will reach to the circular other tissues, and also it produces stimulation and directly enters into the brain. After the its completion of work, immediately from the brain again it enters into the venous vessel, and again it enters into the alveoli. It is a vice versa process: alveoli to blood, blood to brain, and again brain to blood, and blood to alveoli. So this is the general transportation of the anesthesia occur during inhalational condition. Okay, so this is mainly depends on partial pressure and also blood gas partition coefficient. So what is blood gas partition coefficient? Mainly depends upon the potency of the drug. What is potency? It is inversely proportional to minimum alveolar concentration. That means if a increase in blood solubility of the drug, suppose if you take a drug, here two drugs are present. Okay, so that is nitrous oxide and halothane. So here nitrous oxide, the induction is very faster. Why? Because it will be decreasing its solubility. If any drug in blood it is less soluble, it is faster in the inducing agent. That means it will act very faster. Any drug, if it is increasing its blood solubility, then the particles which are free to move through the lipid bilayer will be slower. That's why it is causing very slow action. Okay, here you can see where blood gas partition coefficient is higher for halothane, that's why it is acting very slowly. And nitrous oxide, it is very less, that's why it is acting very faster. Okay, and so increase, this is sometimes it is confusing. I will tell you one thing. If you take two tanks, that means or two glasses, take equal quantity of water in both. In one tank you that means glass, you pour sugar and stir it. What happens? The sugar will dissolve nicely and water level will not increase. And in another glass you pour some stones. What happens? The water level will increase and pressure will also increase. So what it indicates? If it is highly soluble, it won't show any effect. Okay, if it is not soluble and instead of that it is increasing its volume, what happens? It will increase its pressure. In the same way, if anesthetic is soluble, pressure will not rise, and if, especially in a blood you should remember. And if it is not quickly soluble, automatically the pressure will increase, and whenever the partial pressure is going to increase, then the drug will be acting faster. And highly lipid soluble drugs will have stronger action than low lipid soluble drugs. These low lipid soluble drugs are very mild to act. That's why oil gas partition coefficient is very very important. Okay, so what are the other factors? Means alveolar exchange, we discussed that from alveoli to blood and blood to again brain. So this should be we will call it as ventilation. Pulmonary ventilation should be very helpful for delivery of general anesthetic to the alveoli. So hyperventilation will bring more anesthetic per minute, and respiratory depression will have the opposite effect. Okay, so that means the respiratory depression will be more whenever the drug is acting very faster. So we should check for pulmonary ventilation, alveolar exchange, and also solubility of anesthetic in blood and solubility of anesthetic in tissues. So and also cerebral blood flow. These are the main pharmacokinetics of the to be monitored while giving anesthetics. Okay, and elimination of general anesthetic. So how we are eliminating the drug? Means you know that lungs is a main gaseous, means it move from the lungs especially. So exchange is also same channel, isn't it? So why? Because from your brain again it should reach the alveoli and expiration should occur. Okay, so these muscles will become more intermediates in this process, and complete excretion of the drugs will be present mostly. Mainly there is a no metabolism process much significant in this condition. Only halothane, which is more than 20% metabolized in liver, but other drugs will be excreted as such when compared to the halothane drug. Okay, and recovery may be delayed in prolonged anesthetics for highly lipid soluble agents. That means if highly lipid soluble means these tissues will be more taking up the drug, and removal from the tissues again to the alveoli will be slower. So that is this is the main important points in elimination. Okay, so generally what are the before going to individual drugs, there are three techniques of inhalation of anesthetics procedures, especially open drop method and through anesthetic machines, that is open system, closed system and semi-closed system. These are the three systems that is present for giving anesthesia. Okay, so this is not that much important. And coming to individual drugs, this diethyl ether, it is colorless, highly volatile liquid with a pungent odor, and boiling point will be 35 degrees centigrade and produces irritating vapors and or inflammable and explosive. Okay, so this is as this producing highly irritating vapors, this ether is omitted from usage, and also the nerve endings will be showing more effects by usage of some competitive neuromuscular blockers, and all some other adverse effects are also there with the diethyl ether. Especially mostly these are the advantages: margin of safety will be more and respiratory stimulus, and we can go for maximum dosage, everything, no cardiac arrhythmias. But in disadvantages, it is highly inflammable and cardiac arrest will be more. Okay, so this is the about nitrous oxide. It is laughing gas, and whenever it is enters into our body, it will be degraded into N2O plus H2O, and it is mainly given in the combination as 70% nitric oxide plus 30% of oxygen, 25-30% of oxygen, and 0.2-2% of nitrogen or carbon dioxide, like that. Some combination will be given in a cylinders. Okay, so in some dental extractions and smooth process, we are giving this nitrous oxide, and this is the main advantages and disadvantages of the nitrous oxide. And halothane, it is a fluorinated volatile liquid. So what is a halothane? Especially it is a volatile liquid, but it is inhalational. Okay, so potent anesthetic, 2-4% for induction and 0.5-1% for maintenance. In any anesthesia condition, there is three conditions, that is induction, maintenance and removal of the anesthetic. So induction means at which concentration we are inducing the anesthesia condition, and maintenance means till surgery, at how much time it is lasting for without immobility of the person is a main thing. And removal means how the drug is eliminated from the, how faster after our procedure, how faster the drug is eliminating from our body is another important point. Coming to halothane pharmacokinetics, it is 60-80% eliminated unchanged and 20% retained in body for 24 hours and metabolized. So these are the main halothane disadvantages. Mainly it is causing arrhythmia and direct vagal stimulation. That's why this is also giving some adverse effects. That's why this proper usage will be, continuous monitoring will be there while using this halothane drug. Pharyngeal, laryngeal reflexes are abolished and coughing is suppressed and bronchi dilate. All these advantages will be present even though it is having this main condition. And rapid external cooling can be given by bicarbonate infusion, 100% oxygen inhalation, and IV dantrolene can be given whenever there is high effects with this drug. Okay, so and coming to enflurane, this is same as halothane and everything. 1/10 of the halothane dose is enough when given in combination, and this is mainly it releases fluoride ions. That's why it will cause renal toxicity. Okay, so this is one of the disadvantage with the enflurane. And coming to isoflurane, this is also having the isomer of enflurane, having similar properties. Induction is 1.5-3% and maintenance dose is 1-2%. Okay, so these are the advantages and disadvantages of isoflurane. You can go through these. And intravenous anesthetics, these will be helpful for induction. One arm brain circulation time should be monitored. That means how much drug entering into the brain by direct injecting into the venous system should be noted. And in intravenous, inducing agents will be thiopentone, methohexitone, sodium propofol and etomidate. And benzodiazepines will be slower acting drugs. This classification. So thiopentone sodium is a barbiturate, which is ultra short acting, water soluble and alkaline. So this thiopentone sodium is also given on repeated injection. The extracerebral sites are gradually filled up and lower doses produce anesthesia, which lasts longer. Okay, so ultimate disposal occurs mainly by hepatic metabolism, that is elimination T-half is 7 to 12 hours. Okay, so and CNS depression may persist more than 12 hours. This is very important for surgical procedure to be performed in CNS depression condition. Okay, and another propofol drug, this is nowadays it is replacing thiopentone sodium. Oily liquid used as 1% emulsion. Induction in the brain is very faster, that is 15 to 45 seconds and lasts for 5 to 10 minutes. And rapid distribution, half-life is 2 to 4 minutes. And it can be maintenance dose of 9 mg per kg per hour given, can be given as the maintenance dose. And it is highly extensively metabolized in the liver. And 88% of the administered dose appears in the urine. Okay, so this is mainly by metabolized by hepatic conjugation of the inactive glucuronide metabolites. Okay, so this is mainly about propofol. And coming to ketamine, ketamine is another important drug used nowadays. It is mainly a dissociative anesthetic belonging to hallucinogenic phencyclidine. Okay, that means it is related to hallucinogenic phencyclidine group, which is induces dissociative anesthesia. Dissociation means what we are nowadays we are doing in lockdown, we are dissociated from other people. In the same way, our body will be present and analgesia, immobility, amnesia, everything, light reflex, sleeping, everything will be abolished and the person will be in another state where he is very free. Okay, that means his soul will be moving out of the body to a separate region, that is called as dissociation. Our soul is dissociated completely from our body, like that feeling will be present by using this drug. Okay, so this primary site of action of ketamine is the cortex and subcortical areas, not in the reticular activating system. This is one important point to be known by the ketamine. What is the main site of action means it is in the cortex and subcortical areas. And another one is respiration is not depressed in this condition by using ketamine, and also muscle tone increases, limb movements occur and eyes may remain open. Okay, so these are the condition. A dose of 1 to 3 mg per kg IV or 5 mg per kg IM produces the above effects within a minute. That means what are those cardiac rate, cardiac output and blood pressure elevation by sympathetic system will occur within 5 minutes. Okay, and so this ketamine has been used for operations on the head, neck, in patients who have bled, in the asthmatics and in those who want to lose consciousness for short operations. All these persons can be given with this ketamine. Okay, so this is this is the disadvantages of ketamine and these are the uses of ketamine. Okay, and coming to fentanyl, this is a neuroleptic analgesia, domperidol. It is very short acting, 30 to 50 minutes, and in combination with diazepam used in diagnostic endoscopic and angiographic procedures to relieve pain, and adjunct to spinal and nerve block anesthesia. Okay, and coming to complications of anesthesia, these are the general complications of anesthesia. This is during anesthesia there will be respiratory depression, salivation, respiratory secretions will be abolished, and cardiac arrhythmias is fall in blood pressure, everything. These are the following, you know very well, you don't know, no need to explain the meanings. And after anesthesia, these are the conditions we can observe. Nerve palsies means there will be decreased excitation of nerves at the atomic ganglia especially. So that condition is called nerve palsies. That means immediate stimulation will not be there after depression of that neuronal ganglia. Okay, so these is the complications of anesthesia. And coming to properties of general anesthesia, there are mainly three persons we need to take care of that we should keep in mind while giving some general anesthetic or identifying one new general anesthetic. That is, for patient it should be pleasant, non-irritating, and should not cause nausea, vomiting, and induction and recovery should be very faster. And for surgeon who is going to operate the person, he is should have the person, that means the patient should be relieved from pain, that is analgesia and immobility and muscle relaxation. And anesthesia should be, that means the drug should be non-explosive and non-inflammable. Why? Because there are very costly equipment present in the operation theater with so many gases. So if one explosion is there or it is catching some fire, immediately there will be a explosion in that particular area where it causing loss of more huge damage to the particular persons or region. So the drugs should be not explosive and also non-inflammable. And for the anesthetist, it should be margin of safety will be more, that means no fall in blood pressure, heart, liver and other organs should not be affected, and it should be very potent. Potent means always remember, with minimum dose it should show high efficacy and therapeutic availability will be more. And this should be cheap, stable and easily stored, and should not react with rubber tubing or soda lime. Why? Because this should be from cylinders, it should be given through rubber tubes only. You know that mask, how the mouth pumps will be present, and tubing, everything, and or soda lime. And rapid adjustment of depth of anesthesia should be possible. Okay, these are the main properties of the general anesthetic to be given. Okay, so these are the references of general anesthesia, that is clinical applications of by Lippincott, and essentials of medical pharmacology by KD Tripathi is important. You can go through this.